Well, here's something you don't see every day. On April 11th, the day of WrestleMania 37 Night 2, the names AEW, Tony Khan, Kenny Omega, Young Bucks, and Orange Bloody Cassidy were featured in official WWE programming. Hell, 2 hours into Chris Jericho's appearance on Steve Austin's Broken Skull Sessions, they display a picture of Jericho holding the AEW title. I mean, sure, the program chapters only ever refer to All Elite Wrestling as, quote, a new company. But man, it's something to hear Steve Austin say AEW on WrestleMania weekend. While the two-hour interview between the Rattlesnake and Le Champion might not spill quite as much tea as fans might have liked, there were still plenty of ace stories that made it a hell of a watch. I'm Adam, hailing from Parts Unknown, and here are the 10 biggest takeaways from Chris Jericho on the Broken Skull Sessions. Number 1, another forbidden door opens. Well, the big story going into this show is the proverbial forbidden door between WWE and AEW being smashed in. As you might expect, it's not the main focus of the show, with Austin Jericho instead taking us on a potted retrospective of Y2J's entire career, which makes it all the more amusing that Jericho's big break came from the opening of another forbidden door. In 1996, boss man of New Japan Pro Wrestling Antonio Inoki organized a World Wrestling Peace Festival, an event designed to bring together multiple wrestling promotions for a collaborative show. WCW took part, as did New Japan, Michinoku Pro, WWF did not, of course. Both AAA and CMLL took part, which was surprising considering their rivalry. Lionheart Chris Jericho also took part in a triangle match with Conan and Bam Bam Bigelow. At the event, Jericho met Bischoff, who invited him to be a part of WCW, although apparently Bischoff then left the show before watching Jericho's match. So, yeah. Number 2, leaving WCW. Gosh, working for WCW seems like it'd be hard work. Jericho recounts a number of strange stories, working without a signed contract for the first 17 months of his employment, being told he'd be WCW Shawn Michaels before getting locked in the cruiserweight division, which Jericho compared to being low in an Indian caste system. But the moment he'd provoke Goldberg, and when the pay-per-view match finally came, Goldberg would literally spear him out of his shoes. Despite putting in the work, the money match was consistently rejected, which led to Jericho letting his contract expire and looking for better things. Number 3, Vince McMahon's trust exercise. It seems like everyone's got a Vince is a really weird dude story, which makes sense. Look at him. Jericho's is that during the final months of his WCW contract, he was summoned for a meeting with Vince McMahon at Vince McMahon's house. Jericho attended the secret meeting, ate brownies with Vince, sat in awkwardly on a booking meeting, and then had a brief chat with Vince, with scary old bastard McMahon saying nothing to him except, "Okay, let us know when your contract is up." A confusing day, then. Jericho only realized later that the entire meeting was actually just a test to see if Jericho would blab about it, or if he was someone that Vince could trust. Since word about the meeting didn't get around, he was designated the right type of human to work for WWE. Not a paranoid place to work then, at all. I see. Number 4, don't hate the player, hate the game. Yeah, it turns out WWE was a super paranoid place to join in the late 90s, especially if you were a former WCW guy. Despite a whopper of a debut, Jericho recounts a few stories of him struggling during his first year with the company. Apparently him and Triple H hated each other. That doesn't help. He was consistently being booked to lose. A bunch of WWF guys, the game included, still saw him as a WCW guy who wasn't prepared to adapt to the WWF style. It all came to a head in April 2000, the month after Mania 2000, for which Jericho was originally on the poster before being replaced by Mick Foley, though Jericho doesn't actually mention that, but still worth thinking about. Backstage at the April 17th Raw, Jericho requested a chat with Vince to tell him, "I want out," but never actually made it to that meeting because he found out, oh hey, that's the night they were going to have him briefly win the world title. Jericho describes it as a turning point. He let Triple H lead that match, proved he could play ball with a guy he didn't like. They had a great match together, and after he gave up the belt, Vince said, "Don't worry, you'll have it again someday." And indeed he did. Number 5, the saddest world title win of all time. In probably the funniest section of the interview, Jericho ran down everything that happened the night he became the first ever undisputed champion at Vengeance 2001, and poor lad. First of all, he found out in the least ceremonious way possible, overhearing Vince at catering 3 hours before the show saying to Undertaker, loud enough for Y2J to hear, "You know how you know the business is going down the toilet? We're putting the title on Jericho." Thanks, boss. In front of everyone. The finish of that main event was so overbooked, and Austin was so mentally fried by that point in his career he couldn't keep track and told Jericho, just call it to me. There was no one there backstage when he won because everyone used the main event as a chance to beat the traffic. And later that night, he locked himself out of his hotel room getting a pizza. The guy wouldn't let him back in his room. And when he finally did get back in, he dropped his pizza on the floor. What a night. Number 6, I understood that reference. It's always fun to see where people get the inspiration for their gimmicks, like Ollie Davis' current haircut being inspired by the mayor of Whoville from How the Grinch Stole Christmas. Throughout the show, Jericho outlined a lot of things he had borrowed or referenced during his long career. The whole standing with his back to the crowd entrance thing was inspired by Michael Jackson, who did it at a concert in Mexico while Jericho was wrestling down there. The moss-covered three-handled family gradanza from his list of 1,004 holds was a reference to a Dr. Seuss song sung by the Cat in the Hat. The walk to the stage mocking Goldberg at Full Brawl 98 was an homage to Spinal Tap getting lost on their way to the stage. His countdown to the Millennium debut gimmick was inspired by a similar clock at the post office, and his 2008 heel character, possibly his finest work, was modeled after Javier Bardem's quiet intensity in No Country for Old Men. Number 7, Heartbreak Soulmate. It's no small wonder that Shawn Michaels and Chris Jericho made magic in their 2008 feud if Y2J's WrestleMania 19 story is anything to go by. An underrated Mania classic, the match between the two at the Show of Shows was also the first time that both men were ever in the ring together. In a weird soulmate-level coincidence, Jericho had a flash of inspiration and wrote down the finish of the match in a sporting goods store on the back of a receipt, but didn't know how the match would start. Meanwhile, Shawn had gone away and written up the start of the match, but didn't know how the finish should exactly play out. When both men realized what each other had done, they made heart eyes at each other, combined their two halves of a match, and their Mania rehearsal was done in an unprecedented 10 minutes. Cute. Cute boys. Number 8, an unacceptable position. Full credit to Chris Jericho, despite working for a rival promotion, a promotion that he in fact carried on his back in the first few months based off his WWE generated worldwide fame. Jericho actually has few harsh words to say about WWE. However, despite such professionalism, he does tell a similar style of story over and over again, which paints a picture when taken together, that of plans being changed on him at the last minute. First was Jericho's departure from WWE in 2005, wanting to leave wrestling in general after suffering from burnout. Jericho was repeatedly told he'd be done at SummerSlam, so much so that he booked a holiday with his family to Disneyland the day after, only then to be told at the last minute, no, we need you at Raw. More egregious, powers that be, Jericho didn't name names, tried to change the iconic Festival of Friendship at the last minute to scrap some of the comedic elements, which forced Jericho to contact an absent Vince to back him up. And finally, the straw that broke the camel's back, at Mania 33, Kevin Owens and Jericho's match at the Show was changed from one of the main events over the Universal title, which Jericho would win before dropping it to Brock the next month, to the second match on the card for the US title. According to Jericho, going on second was, quote, unacceptable and made him reevaluate his place in the company. Number 9, the parting of the ways. Chris Jericho's final appearance for WWE was part of the greatest Royal Rumble in the first ever Saudi Arabia WWE show, and the story behind that show is one of an acrimonious breakup. See, Jericho's original deal with New Japan was a match with Kenny Omega at the Tokyo Dome for Wrestle Kingdom 12, and it was going to be a one-off, which was approved by Vince, who told him to go fly the WWE flag in Japan. Jericho lost, but the next night beat up Naito to leave with some heat, but also maybe plant a seed for something in the future, who knows, which made Vince ask, hey, what was that? That wasn't part of the deal. Fast forward to the greatest Royal Rumble, and the original card advertised a casket match between Chris Jericho and The Undertaker. Well, actually, the original plan was for Rusev versus The Undertaker, but that was changed to Jericho. However, before the show, Jericho told Vince that New Japan wanted him back for a match with Naito, and shortly thereafter, Jericho was removed from the match again, and it reverted back to Rusev. Apparently, the Prince wanted the change, which Jericho doesn't believe, but he says this moment made him realize, okay, maybe this New Japan stuff can lead to more, and he became much more open to talking with Tony Khan. And number 10, make wrestling fun again. Without ever really getting explicit about it, throughout the show, Jericho paints a picture of a damaged friendship between him and Vince McMahon. He talks about how Vince used to trust him, although probably not as much these days. He refers to his relationship with Vince in the past tense a lot, but most telling is his description of working with Kenny Omega in New Japan. Putting together their match, he didn't have to approve any of it with anyone, and he said that, quote, wrestling became fun again. By contrast, talking about how if he'd made a different choice and gone back to WWE, he says, I knew what would happen. I knew the first thing I'd have to do is I'd have to put someone on the list. Reading between the lines, it's quite a damning picture. On WWE branded programming, no less. And that's our list. If you like this video, don't forget to like and subscribe to Parts of Unknown for more silly wrestling content. Jam that jam.